Antarctic, the coldest, most desolate environment on Earth. Temperatures here can drop to 100 degrees below zero. Winds can reach 200 miles per hour. No other continent is as inhospitable. In 1900, apart from parts of its coast, it remained utterly unknown. But the turn of the 20th century was to see attention turn to this final land frontier. European nations began to launch expeditions to explore this mysterious southern land. It was a time when successful explorers could become national celebrities. And for a certain type of man, the challenge of exploration proved irresistible. One such man was Ernest Shackleton.
Antarctica is a huge landmass, 1.5 times the size of the United States of America. And 99% of this enormous landmass is covered by ice.
The lowest surface temperature recorded on the planet, minus 89.2 centigrade, was on Antarctica. So it is a decidedly uncomfortable climate. The weather, there's a hell of a lot of it, and it can change quickly.
Born on the 18th of February, 1874, Ernest Henry Shackleton spent his early years in the tranquil surroundings of Ireland's County Kildare, before his Anglo-Irish family moved to England when he was 10. His father Henry, originally a farmer, set up as a doctor in Sydenham, south of London. As a schoolboy at nearby Dulwich College, young Ernest hardly seemed destined for greatness.
He seemed rather bored by formal education at this time. He certainly wasn't inspired by education at Dulwich College. He was not certainly not a violent schoolboy, but we see him not afraid of the rough and tumble of school life in this period.
According to the early accounts of him by one of his sisters, he used to read a tremendous amount of romantic boys' literature. The Boy's Own Paper, very popular amongst the youth of their time. In fact, I think I can just about remember it myself. Yeah. And it was full of exciting stories. I think this is the sort of thing that triggered the idea in Shackleton's mind as a young boy. He was a great reader of romance.
Ernest had already begun to feel the call of the sea. And after leaving Dulwich at the earliest possible opportunity, he joined the Merchant Navy. On the 19th of April, 1890, he set off from Liverpool on his first voyage on the clipper Houghton Tower. He was 16.
The ship was a windjammer type, which took him on a fabulous voyage around Cape Horn and then up the Pacific coast of South America to Chile, where they had to unload and load up with various goods and take them all back to England again. It was a pretty routine trip.
He claimed in later life that he'd rounded Cape Horn for the first time in a blizzard and that he'd felt a call to the south. The Antarctic offered Shackleton a way out of the rigorous, monotonous life of the merchant seaman and an opportunity for advancement and fame.
He was soon to get the chance to follow his dream. The golden age of polar exploration was beginning. In the north, the legendary Fridtjof Nansen reached a record position of 86 degrees north in 1895. Pressure grew for a British expedition, and it fell to the president of the Royal Geographical Society, Sir Clements Markham, to organize the National Antarctic Expedition. Its main aim, to reach the South Pole. To lead the team, Markham appointed a 32-year-old naval lieutenant who would become forever associated with the Antarctic, Robert Falcon Scott. When Ernest Shackleton heard of the plan, he seized the moment. Using his already formidable persuasive powers, he secured a place on the expedition. On the 6th of August 1901, they left for the south.
Yes, the journey from Britain to the Antarctic was a long and difficult sea voyage, but not particularly arduous by the standards of seafaring in those days. Remember, the ship was basically under sail. That was cheaper than coal, and you didn't have to worry about taking vast amounts of coal. But remember also that many of these ships were built for navigation in ice, so you don't do very well for a keel. Anything like that's likely to be knocked off or damaged when you're navigating through ice. So the phrase is sort of built like a bathtub and wallow like a pig.
After sailing into Antarctic waters on Discovery, the expedition established base at McMurdo Sound in the Ross Sea. After camping for the winter, the three men chosen to head for the South Pole set off on the 2nd of November 1902. Robert Scott, Dr. Edward Wilson, and Ernest Shackleton with sledges and dogs. It was a nightmare journey.
Their equipment and organization was inadequate to the task. The diet was inadequate. They were undoubtedly suffering from scurvy by the end of the expedition. Their clothing was inadequate, not up to combating the rigors of the Antarctic environment, the intense wind, the cold, the changes in temperature. Their use of polar transport was very poor. They had a team of 19 dogs and 5 sledges, but instead of dividing the dogs between the sledges, they simply harnessed the 5 sledges in a relay and left the 19 dogs to ride off at the front, and of course made very little progress. They were amateurs in Antarctic exploration, and it showed in the relative lack of progress they made towards the South Pole.
Profound differences in personality between Scott and Shackleton also came to the fore.
Here were two young, ambitious seamen, both drawn to the Antarctic through the opportunity for advancement and fame. And I think Scott felt threatened by the energy, enthusiasm, and charm of this young naval seaman who was very popular. He got on people's nerves as well. And I think that when Shackleton became ill during the march south, Scott allowed the animosity that had developed towards Shackleton to come out, and he wasn't a good leader at that point. He had to be taken aside by Wilson and told to lay off Shackleton, as Scott had criticised him. Scott didn't help matters, of course, by calling Shackleton famously at one point, referring to him as a bloody fool. And Shackleton, of course, turned round and said, well, you're the biggest bloody fool of all of us. And Scott, with his strict naval discipline, found the expression of such sentiments as this almost mutinous.
On the 30th of December, having reached only 82 degrees south, Scott made the decision to halt and turn back while they still had a chance.
By now, the dogs were practically reduced to nothing because they were badly fed, underfed, and the conditions were not good, in fact very bad, and Shackleton began to show signs of physical distress. He started to cough blood. Also, he had a leaky heart, which he hadn't admitted to when he set out from London. In fact, I don't think he had a medical, if I remember rightly. So nobody knew about this leaky heart. Anyhow, what with one thing and another, it all ended up with his having to sit on the sledge for a while Scott and Wilson pulled the sledge along.
5 weeks of indescribable difficulty later, the three men reached base at McMurdo Sound, starving, exhausted and diseased, but alive.
At that time, a relief ship had arrived in the morning. So Scott thought this was a good opportunity to send the invalids back. And with Shackleton having coughed blood and generally, and not seeming too good, Scott thought he'd better give him a medical, so he got Curtis, the doctor, to give him a medical, and suggested, or so it's thought, suggested to Curtis that he, if anything, on the negative side, and get Shackleton sent home. And that's what happened.
This may as well have been influenced by Scott's investment in mounting a Royal Naval expedition. And I don't think it helped Shackleton's cause, the fact that he was a member of the Merchant Navy. And so Scott, in his eagerness to promote a Royal Naval Antarctic expedition, was not too upset to see a merchant seaman sent home. But that said, I think undoubtedly Shackleton was extremely ill.
Back in Britain, Shackleton decided not to return to the Merchant Navy, and instead tried his hand at a number of ventures, including a spell as a journalist, a period as head of the Royal Scottish Geographical Society, and even politics, when he stood as a candidate in the 1906 election. But none of these activities appeared to wholly satisfy his Irish adventurous spirit. Even marriage to an old friend of his sister, Emily Dorman, in April 1904, and the birth of a son and daughter, could not tame his desire to return to the Antarctic.
We see him drifting, trying his hand at different things, and the Antarctic offered Shackleton an opportunity for advancement, an opportunity for fame. Certainly as well, there was the motivation that he had been tarred slightly with the brush of failure after being sent home early from Scott's first expedition, and he was eager to get back and prove himself in the arena of Antarctic exploration after the perceived slight of being sent home from Scott's first expedition.
Wanting to go back to the Antarctic, it's by no means a Shackleton thing. Many persons have done this and made quite a career in Arctic and Antarctic exploration. Now, basically, a man can't do everything, and those are two places where specialized knowledge, specialized techniques are very valuable. And from personal experience, I can say they're truly fascinating and amazing places. They don't necessarily appeal to everyone, but in polar exploration there's plenty of recidivists. Shackleton was but one.
In February 1907, he announced that he had raised the funds to launch his own independent trek south, the British Antarctic Expedition. Again, the aim was the pole. And after setting sail on the 30th of July 1907 in a sealing ship, Nimrod, the British Antarctic Expedition reached McMurdo Sound at the end of January 1908. After a winter of experiments and preparations, Shackleton set off for the pole on the 29th of October 1908 with colleagues Janssen Boyd Adams, Frank Wild, and Dr. Eric Marshall, taking with them not dogs, but Manchurian ponies.
Both Scott and Shackleton's experience on the Discovery expedition had prejudiced them against the use of dogs in polar exploration. I think in many ways this was a result of their ignorance. They weren't experienced dog drivers and they had tremendous difficulty handling the dogs. So for Shackleton, dogs were merely more trouble than they were worth.
Ponies, some expeditions had tried them. They proved themselves reasonably useful in the Arctic, crossing sea ice in places in Franz Josef, but really with ascending crevassed glaciers, when they've got a hoof to try to get traction, they prove themselves really quite inefficient. Pony snowshoes were made. They helped to some extent, but not on the ice. Tragically, I suppose one could say, the greatest contribution the ponies made was by their meat for the dogs.
Initially, their progress was good, and within 4 weeks, they had passed the furthest point south reached by the Scott expedition. And by Christmas Day, they were just 250 miles from the pole. But now, blizzards intervened, preventing any travel at all on some days. As 1909 began, Shackleton realized that their goal would remain out of reach. On the 9th of January, they planted the Union Jack and photographed themselves at the furthest south attained by man. By Shackleton's own calculations, They were just 97 miles from the pole.
Shackleton's decision to turn back when 97 miles from the South Pole has, I think, to stand as possibly the greatest decision in the history of polar exploration. I think if they'd gone on to the pole, and Shackleton himself was certainly driven, they would have died. They would have starved on the return journey.
The calculation on how much food they had, that they'd reach the pole but starve on the way back, was the essential part. And on the return journey, just before they got back to the base camp, they had bad weather and very close to did starve. Those were quite finely done calculations.
They may have failed to reach the pole, but their achievement in getting so close was undeniable. The British public certainly agreed. Overnight, Shackleton became a national hero. Fêted by society on his return to England in June 1909, he became Sir Ernest Shackleton by the end of the year. Parliament voted him £20,000 to help clear the expedition's debts. Shackleton produced a best-selling book describing his Antarctic adventures, and he lectured to packed houses on the subject all over Europe. For one man, however, Sir Ernest's new celebrity was galling. That man was Robert Scott. Before Nimrod set sail in 1908, Scott had insisted to Shackleton that he make his Antarctic base away from McMurdo Sound. Scott was already planning his own next trip south, and he felt that since it was his 1902 expedition that discovered McMurdo Sound, he had the right to be the next to use it. Shackleton reluctantly agreed, but, as we have seen, used the base anyway.
Shackleton certainly did not want to land and make Hut Point and McMurdo Sound his base camp. He did not want to break the promise that he had made to Scott that he would not use the old Discovery base camp on his expedition. But he was forced to change his mind by the ice conditions he encountered. He sailed along in the hope of finding a base camp on King Edward VII Land, but unfortunately the Ross Ice Shelf had changed considerably in the few years since the departure of the Discovery in 1904. And the area of land which he had hoped to make his base camp on simply wasn't there anymore. He sailed around looking for an alternative base camp. He then thought that he should maybe return to McMurdo Sound. He didn't want to. He waited 48 hours, but eventually I think he was faced with little choice, either to camp at McMurdo Sound or to abandon the expedition. And he was also placed under considerable pressure by the captain of the ship, Captain England, who was very concerned with the safety of the ship and urged him strongly to go to McMurdo Sound and make his base camp at the old Discovery base camp.
But in those Edwardian days, the concept of a gentleman's word being his bond was still paramount. Scott and Shackleton would never meet privately again. When Scott's next attempt at his goal began in 1910, he felt confident the prize would be his. Scott's expedition is now, of course, the stuff of legend. He did indeed reach the pole in January 1912, only to find a black flag flying there, left by the team of Roald Amundsen, an experienced explorer. There can be few British folk unfamiliar with how the ailing Captain Lawrence Oates left his tent to die in the hope that it would save his colleagues. A hope that was, of course, forlorn. When the legend of Scott of the Antarctic began to form, Shackleton began to yearn for the South once more.
Many people who travel to the Antarctic talk of the spell that this wonderful natural environment casts over them. And they say that when they return home, they forget the hardships that were involved in living in the Antarctic and remember only the beauty, the sense of awe and wonder at nature's majesty that they felt in the Antarctic. Well, we should also remember another reason people explore is because it isn't here. The Antarctic offered Shackleton an escape from the monotony and the mundane reality of daily life. And I think if there is an obsession, it was an obsession to live again in this wonderful, majestic natural environment with its opportunities of adventure and excitement.
At the very end of 1913, Shackleton announced a new expedition to the Antarctic and immediately began preparations. His plan was daring. He intended to make a crossing of the Antarctic continent via the South Pole itself. On one ship, he would sail into the icy Weddell Sea to set up base at Wazel Bay. At the same time, another ship would enter the Ross Sea to berth at the familiar McMurdo Sound. A land party would then head towards the pole, laying depots of provisions. Shackleton would then march to the pole from Wazel Bay, taking dogs this time, before returning by the depot route to McMurdo Sound. By the summer of 1914, he had the men and the resources to depart, including the ships Aurora, which would carry the depot team, and Polaris, a 300-ton barkentine built for a Norwegian expedition that never took place. Shackleton renamed it Endurance, after his family motto, "By endurance I conquer." It was to be an appropriate name. By August 1914, Shackleton was ready to depart. But events far beyond his control now threatened the expedition. Europe was on the point of war.
I think if the war had broken out during the preparations for the expedition, there was a very good chance that Shackleton himself might have decided to put the expedition on hold and get involved in the war. But the fact that the preparations were so advanced that the Endurance was on the point of departure, indeed had departed by the time Britain actually entered the war, swung the balance towards the continuation of the expedition.
Endurance had sailed on the way to the Antarctic and the war began. Shackleton offered his ship, everybody aboard, and everything for the war effort if needed. And one of these excellent signals that he should proceed was received. At those days, at the beginning of the war, it was thought it would not last very long. 1914 to 18 was a lot longer, and they emerged from Elephant Island still finding it in full swing, if I can put it that way, and many men subsequently enlisted.
By November, Shackleton and the Endurance were docked at South Georgia, a desolate southern island inhabited only by the hardy whalers of the southern seas. They were now out of wireless contact with the world and its war. When they left the island on the 8th of December, they cut their ties with civilization completely and headed into the Weddell Sea on the first stage of their journey, where they would have to negotiate the perils of pack ice.
Pack ice is a particular problem on the frozen sea, Arctic and Antarctic. Seawater itself freezes at minus 1.8 centigrades, but as well as the ice, you actually get salt water brine in it. And as distinct from freshwater ice, it's resilient, it's almost bouncy. You can hit it and bounce off. Trying to get your way through it with explosives won't work. Ordinary freshwater ice, as you know, on the surface of ponds is brittle. So you've got something that is strong and resilient and you're trying to hit it and break through. A lot of energy doesn't get you very far. Now, as the winter develops, it gets thicker and thicker. The cold on the surface is freezing the sea beneath. That's all right if it's more or less flat and in level and an area with no currents and not much wind. But Endurance was in the Weddell Sea. Here you have the Weddell Sea gyre circulating. And at the northwest side, it all reaches the land and various islands and rafts up above itself. Sections of the ice rise above each other in the pressure, force over it, and 1 meter might become 2 meters or more thick. You'll find big ridges rising in this area, effectively the mills of ice.
Despite the ice, Endurance sailed on south throughout December. Christmas was celebrated merrily and optimism was high. The day before Christmas, the second ship, Aurora, sailed south from Tasmania into the Ross Sea. The expedition was proceeding as planned. But early in the new year came the first signs of trouble. Endurance spent 5 days immobilized in the pack ice. By January the 10th, they were back on course, and the crew soon had their first sight of the Antarctic coast. Soon, they were within 60 miles of their destination. Then, on the 19th of January 1915, the ice closed around Endurance once more. This time, it would not release its grip.
I think the negotiation of pack ice is always a gamble. It's always risky. And I'm not sure there was much they could have done to avoid the Endurance being trapped in the ice. It was bad luck.
I think in that particularly difficult sea ice year with 1914 technology, there was nothing they could have done. There were ice saws, long metal blades which cut through the ice and would try to lead the ship out or to make a clear area long enough for the ship to get up full speed and hit the ice at the end of it. These were all tried but were unsuccessful. And ferrying it, poling it, a system of sallying ship where all the men are on the port and the order go to starboard and they're running backwards and forwards trying to move it and wriggle out of the ice. Virtually everything was tried. And with the ice in that exceptionally difficult year, I think we can say with hindsight, there was no hope.
Shackleton and his men could do nothing but wait on the ship. But as days turned into weeks, it became clear that the expedition was in real trouble. By the end of February, the feeble Antarctic summer had already passed, and Shackleton accepted the inevitable in his diary. The temperatures were very low both day and night, but as the pack was freezing solidly around the ship, I could no longer doubt that the Endurance was bound for the winter. The dark Antarctic midwinter would last until the end of July, and there would be no hope of escape before then. With their fate utterly unknown to a preoccupied outside world, Endurance continued its miserable drift north. The hope now was that the ice would soon release the Endurance. Instead, it was about to crush it.
The ship was basically twisted. Her planks were sprung, she was filling with water. The pressure remained. The ice, in various places, came through the hull. So you had a doomed ship, largely full of water, but still effectively, I will say, on the surface rather than afloat, because she was held up by the ice.
October the 27th, 1915, saw the fateful order given to abandon the Endurance. After retrieving as much as they could from the stricken vessel, including the precious lifeboats, the team of men made camp as best they could on the ice. Without a ship, in the middle of the sea, Shackleton informed the men of his intentions with inspirational simplicity. "So now, we'll go home," he announced. It was easier said than done.
They were in a desperate situation, and looking back, the situation looks almost hopeless. But Shackleton's gift was for inspiring leadership, for inspiring the men around him to believe in the goal that he had set. And this was essential to keep away the lack of spirits, the bad morale, which otherwise would have destroyed the expedition. It perhaps at that stage, what wasn't so important as the realizability of his plans was the fact that he had set a goal which could keep the crew motivated.
Shackleton first proposed marching over the ice to the land. With the ice drifting north, a march west would, he hoped, bring them to Graham Land on the Antarctic Peninsula. 3 days after abandoning Endurance, they began to move. Teams of dogs and men pulling what they could on sledges, including the lifeboats. It was a short journey. Marching and pulling in soft snow without skis, their progress was virtually nil. After 2 days, Shackleton called a halt.
When they started to try to move off across the ice to the next camp, taking the boats to get to the ice edge, they didn't get very far. Travelling conditions were far more severe than expected, and they had two methods of travel. On the ice, the boats were on the sledges. Later on, the sledges might have been on the boats as necessary. But with all the pressure ridges and the nature of the ice, this was extremely hard work. They didn't get very far before they set up the next camp and gave that trekking up as not worth the effort. And from there, they were able to return to the ship. And remember, you've got quite a substantial shipwreck. Plenty of firewood from that.
Endurance finally sank on the 21st of November. For the next 4 months, Shackleton and his men remained on the drifting ice. For food, they killed seal and penguin whenever they could. That they were able to eat any fresh meat at least kept the dreaded scurvy at bay. For drinking water, they had the sea ice, which is naturally purged of salt. For washing, they had virtually nothing. They grew filthier by the day. Shackleton knew that, in their desperate situation, the needs of the mind were as important as the needs of the body.
He realized they were in a desperate situation, and he realized that one of his key roles as leader of the expedition was to keep morale high, to keep setting goals, to keep the men focused, to try and keep spirits up. Because if people became demoralized, discontent would spread, and it was likely that the expedition would then fail and the consequences could have been disastrous.
Having drifted 1,000 miles north since Endurance was trapped, the ice was now, at last, beginning to break apart. On the 9th of April 1916, with the floes breaking up all around them, they took to the boats.
The situation was desperate when the crew set off in the three boats. There was still meat and seal meat, but this was getting very monotonous. A very desperate situation was faced. Morale was beginning to, must have been coming under pressure. And the prospect of spending the Antarctic winter on the ice would have been a terrible one to confront.
Three flimsy vessels on some of the toughest seas on the planet, powered only by oars and makeshift sail. It was to be a tortuous journey. The conditions were appalling.
Boils, the beginnings of frostbite. Many of the men suffered from dysentery, from eating uncooked dog meat pemmican, and they had to relieve themselves over the side of the boats. Hunger, terrible thirst. Shackleton himself is said to have gone 100 hours without sleeping during this boat journey. And Frank Wild later wrote that he thought when they arrived at Elephant Island that half of the crew were insane.
7 days after launching, they arrived at Elephant Island, a barren outpost of rock and ice 20 miles long. With fresh water available at last, the men were almost delirious, as Shackleton noted. Some of the men were reeling about the beach as if intoxicated. They were laughing uproariously, picking up stones and letting handfuls of pebbles trickle between their fingers like miners over hoarded gold. Despite their achievement, Shackleton knew their difficulties were far from over. Although there was fresh water to drink and birds and seals to eat, they had arrived at a place where no one would ever think of looking for them. Indeed, they were Elephant Island's first visitors for 86 years. They would have to go to sea again. And, because of the direction of the winds, their only chance was to head for South Georgia, the whaling island where they knew they would find relief. It was 800 miles away.
In the circumstances, it was the best chance of getting rescue, but it was hardly a good chance. The things in their favor, the wind and the currents go in the direction of South Georgia. Indeed, an enormous amount of wind and an enormous amount of current and sea conditions go that way. And the island is well placed. If you consider it a sort of new moon shape, they were aiming for it for the southwestern coast, which is, as far as the island goes, a reasonably large object. It's still difficult navigation, but anywhere on that coast is more attainable than, for instance, the South Sandwich Islands, South Shetland Islands, or other islands that don't present such a favorable aspect to the wind and currents.
Reckoning that it wasn't worth all the men risking the journey to South Georgia, a party of six was assembled. Shackleton himself, Worsley, Vincent the boatswain, Second Officer Tom Crean, Seaman Timothy McCarthy, and McNeish. On the 24th of April, they put to sea once more, leaving behind the men whose survival now depended on them.
They'd done the best for preparing her. She was well ballasted with rocks, stones from the beach on Elephant Island, on which the men had to sleep, which was hardly comfortable. The sleeping bags there, they slowly became sodden, of course. The decks, she was decked over with what materials they had and items from the other boats and covered with canvas. But she leaked. She was 8.23 meters long and going through some of the most tempestuous oceans on the planet.
By the 7th of May, they were within 100 miles of land. But Shackleton now had to make a decision on which the lives of all were to depend. Worsley's intention was to approach South Georgia's western side before heading across the northern coast to the whaling stations. With their position not entirely certain, however, Shackleton feared that the wind would carry them past the islands west and out into open ocean and certain doom. He insisted on a slight change of course to the east. It was a crucial decision. The next day, they arrived at the uninhabited southern coast of South Georgia, and with mighty seamanship in the teeth of a hurricane, the James Caird came to rest in a small cove at King Haakon Bay. It was the 10th of May, 1916. Shackleton's judgment had saved their lives. Exhausted, the six men took time to recover from their 17-day voyage. But all knew that they would somehow have to make contact with the whalers on the north of the island. By sea, it was a journey of 150 miles, and it was doubtful whether their boat would survive the trip. Instead, Shackleton decided to make the journey overland, over the utterly uncharted South Georgian interior.
I suppose, bearing in mind what we now know about the difficulty of crossing the island, he might have reconsidered. But his map of South Georgia was woefully inadequate. It was reasonable for the shores, but there were no contours or nothing indicating any situation in the chart of the fact that it had mountains approaching 3,000 meters in it. He had insufficient knowledge of. Mind you, he soon found out.
They moved the James Caird up to the end of King Haakon Bay and turned it upside down for shelter. McNeish, Vincent and McCarthy would stay there, while the other three would attempt to cross the mountains and glaciers of the island to find assistance. Profoundly ill-equipped for such a journey, they set off nonetheless in the early morning of the 19th of May. To save weight, they took no sleeping bags.
Having surmounted the boat journey from Elephant Island to South Georgia, I think they must have thought, we're so close now, we're so close to success, to saving our comrades, our companions left behind on the island, that it drove them through and on to make this journey that had never been made before across the mountains to the whaling station.
With the weather remarkably favourable, they pressed on hour after hour. But when they encountered the five pinnacles of the Trident mountain ridge, their progress slowed. Of the four passes through the ridge, The first led to a 2,000-foot precipice, and the second proved utterly inaccessible. When they looked over the third pass, they had to make a decision. With time running out, they decided to chance the slope on the other side, by toboggan.
I think they had no choice. They certainly couldn't have survived a night out on the mountainside in tattered clothes with no sleeping bags. And tired as they were, climbers will tell you that climbing down is the time that often mistakes are made when you're not concentrating as hard. Well, given the conditions that these men had endured over the last 2 weeks, they certainly were in no fit state to negotiate a very difficult to descent. So in some ways we can see this mad toboggan ride as an act of impetuosity. But in another way, it may have been a more sensible decision to say, yes, we just at this stage, a difficult descent would be even more of a danger, and we must now just throw caution to the wind and go for it.
They dropped 1,500 feet in 3 minutes before stopping. They were all safe, but they were still only halfway there. At 6:30 on the second morning, after just 5 minutes of rest, they found themselves on another ridge when they heard a noise. It sounded like a steam whistle. When they heard it again at 7, they knew. It was a whistle, summoning the men of the whaling station to their day's work. Overjoyed, they shook each other's hands. They had heard sound created by other men. Their determination was redoubled. Nothing would stop them now. Not even a 500-foot descent of fearsome blue ice, which they negotiated by cutting steps. After 18 months, 1,000 miles of drift in endurance, 1,000 miles adrift on the ice, the three-boat journey to Elephant Island, the 800-mile trip to South Georgia, followed by the first-ever crossing of the island, they came across their first external human company. Two young boys. Soon, though, the three men located the station manager, Thoralf Sørle, and revealed their identities to the astonished Norwegian, who immediately set to providing for their needs. A steaming hot bath, a shave, clean clothes, and mountainous quantities of food were laid on. As they sat at dinner, the three explorers related their amazing tale. Grimly, they were also informed of the events of the Great War.
It's easy, given the drama of the journey, to ignore the tremendous sense of shock and disjuncture which news of the First World War must have brought Shackleton when he arrived at the whaling station. News of submarine warfare, of the use of poison gas, of war in the air. This was a world transformed by the greatest conflict that had yet been staged in human history.
I might add that when one is in the Antarctic, you might consider the isolation could cause things to become a little strange. But when you are living in the Antarctic and listening to the radio and the things the rest of the world does to itself, you wonder who's gone mad. I suspect they thought the world had gone mad then.
The three men at King Haakon Bay were quickly picked up by a transport ship from the whaling station. The Elephant Island group were also rescued, but only after three attempts to reach them were thwarted by ice.
I think the leadership that Shackleton showed in all of the four expeditions he was involved was significant. Endurance, of course, it was put to the hardest test. To keep everyone together with various problems, there was virtually mutiny on one occasion and difficulties of this nature, kept them together, remained on good terms with many, maintained a command, and got the party for which he was responsible all out alive and in very difficult circumstances, is a major tribute.
It was a source of genuine pride for him. He had proved himself a leader of men. By January 1922, Sir Ernest Shackleton was back in the south. He now had plans to circumnavigate the Antarctic continent. He simply couldn't stay away. This time, however, it was not to be. On the 7th of January 1922, back on South Georgia, he suffered a heart attack and died. He was 47. On the 5th of March 1922, Sir Ernest Henry Shackleton was buried on South Georgia, a location utterly fitting in death for the man who had survived so much in life.
I think everybody liked him. Everybody liked him. To have lived with him, it would have been quite impossible, of course, but he was a great man, Shackleton.
I think in normal circumstances, Shackleton was probably quite annoying, rather full of himself, always wanting to be the centre of attention. However, if you were in a tight spot, I don't think there's anyone you'd rather have had with you.